Yeah, hello, this is Anoop.
Hi, Anoop, how are you?
Good, good. How are you, Rakesh?
I'm all right, thank you.
Okay, good. So you're just starting now?
We'll have a welcome at 9:15.
Okay, fine. Okay.
All right.
So I just mute myself for some time and then you can let me know when you're ready for me.
Okay? Yeah, so after the, you know, I should take maybe 10 minutes or so.
Okay.
Yeah. And then we can start your keynote.
Okay, sounds good.
Can you all see my slides? Anoop, can you see my slides?
Yes, I can see your slides.
All
yes.
Right. Thank you.
Okay, good. You know, like I'm in New Jersey right now, and what happened was yesterday we lost power.
Oh, yeah, I heard about the storm. Actually, one of my students is there for the summer.
Yeah.
He also mentioned that he had power outage and no Wi-Fi, everything was gone.
Right, right. So even now we don't have power at our house, but I found another place to go to. So I'm going to be in this other place and then here we have Wi-Fi and power. So
I hope there wasn't much damage or anything.
A lot of trees have fallen down, you know, but on my property there is not much damage.
Okay.
But some wires are down and the crew is still not there to, you know, fix it up. So
yeah,
there's always a backlog, right? So it'll take some time for them.
Right.
Yeah. Right. So hopefully by today evening, we should get it back, you know.
Good luck with everything.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, some people have installed this backup generators and backup, you know, power in their house, but I don't have it yet. Yeah.
Yeah, we had a hurricane once, and I bought a propane stove because we had lost power for a few hours. We were lucky. Mm-hmm. We got it back pretty quickly, but some people were not so lucky. Anoop, I'm going to make you a co-host.
Okay. Let me see what happened here. It's not going up. One second. Why is this? Like, it's a small unit, but it's not expanding on my.
It should be a full screen option.
Okay, let me see. I mean, I minimized it, so now it should be some full screen. Okay, yeah, now it's okay. So Rakesh, I've opened my slides. I have to share the screen, right?
At 9:30.
Yeah, at 9:30.
I'll stop sharing after my presentation, and then you can start from there. We'll temporarily stop sharing just to make sure nobody's waiting to be let in. And I'll make okay. I wish I have made you a co-host so you can let people in and also, you know, we can start the recordings.
Okay. All right, Dr. Vimal.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. And then I can start sharing again. Okay, so it's 9:15. We'll get started. Welcome everybody to the 6th ACM International Workshop for Security and Privacy Analytics. It's quite a mouthful, so we call it IWSPA. And it's a pleasure to welcome you all on behalf of the program committee and the program co-chairs. Professor Mohan from Syracuse University, Professor Khan from UT Dallas, and I'm Rakesh Verma from the University of Houston. So first of all, it's very important to thank all of the people who have helped with IWSPA. It's you know, it's never a one-person effort. So the whole program committee and the co-chairs were IWSPA to 2020. I owe a lot of thanks to them and the organizing committee as well. The additional reviewers, we had 11 additional reviews. My PhD student, Avisha Das, who is also present today, she helped a lot with the publicity of IWSPA and you know, lots of other things as well. And I should also thank the members of my lab. We call it Reasoning and Data Analytics for Cybersecurity, REDAS, for a lot of help with the publicity. All the authors for submitting papers and making this program, this great program possible. And of course, all of you attendees and the University of Houston, who's a departmental Zoom account we are using and who helped in lots of other ways as well. So bird's eye view of IWSPA 2020 by the numbers, we got 18 abstracts by the submission deadline and 14 papers were submitted. We had 46 reviews in all. As I mentioned, we had 11 external reviews and the rest were done by the program committee members. So we accepted 5 papers as full and 3 as short. Plus we have 2 exciting tutorials and 1 keynote. We are very lucky to have the tutorials and the keynote speaker, Dr. Anoop Singhal from NIST, who has joined us. A little bit about the exchanges that happened. So there were 314 emails and lots of participants on each email. So you can imagine how much traffic we created on the internet. Also 146 events were recorded in Easy Chair as well. So let's see. The slide doesn't want to advance for some reason. I think I've lost the focus on this one. Let me temporarily stop sharing and restart because I think in the middle something happened. Interesting. Visha, you have my slides. Can you bring them up, please?
Yes, Dr. Verma. Give me 1 second.
Sorry about that. All right, so so you can move to the next slide. Okay, so I thought I would just, since this is the 6th ACM IWSPA, I thought, you know, I would just take a look at the past IWSPAs and see, you know, how the papers have fared that we selected over the past year. So one question I have is, what is the most downloaded paper for IWSPAs from 2015 to 19 as per ACM Digital Library. So go ahead and click the answer. I doubt anyone knows, but you can raise your hand. So it's the privacy guide paper from IWSPA 2018, which has close to 1900 downloads already. You can see it's just been 2 years, slightly over 2 years since the paper came out. And the other question is, which is the most cited paper for IWSPAs as per Google Scholar? Let's pause. Let's see if anybody can come up with that. Please raise your hand or just unmute yourself and speak. So if you know the answer to this one, okay, Avisha, go ahead and click. So it's the evaluation of Android malware calls paper from IWSPA 2016, which has over 50 citations according to Google Scholar when last I checked yesterday. Okay, next slide, please. So there are not many data points, but still there is a curious pattern I noticed in our past IWSPAs. So the even years seem to have the most downloads. So 2016, 2018, and 2020 is also off to a very fast start. So the pattern seems to be holding. And then 15, 17, and 19, the downloads are a little bit lower. I don't know why this happens, but anyway, it is what it is. Next slide, please. Okay. So I wanted to give an update because IWSPA is not just about papers, it's also about building the community. And you know, some of you may not know actually that we started with a capacity expansion grant from the National Science Foundation. That's when we decided to hold the first IWSPA workshop. And at IWSPA 2018, I gave a tutorial on security analytics. And I had mentioned that we are also teaching a course on security analytics at the University of Houston since about 2015 as well. And there is no suitable text for that one. And then an audience member had asked me, you know, why don't you write one? And so, you know, I have some interesting news for you. So Avisha, go ahead and click, please. So we have, I have co-authored a book on cybersecurity analytics, and I plan to use it for my course in the spring 2021 semester. So it's joint work with Dr. David Marchette from, he's in the Navy in Washington, DC. All right, next slide, please. So our morning agenda starts with a keynote by Anoop, you know, I already mentioned. And then we have a privacy paper, a long presentation. We take a break and then a secure data outsourcing tutorial and a couple of short papers on data sets and benchmarking. We have a data sets and benchmarking paper for the first time. And we have a paper on hate speech and offensive language. Next slide, please. And in the afternoon, We have the adversarial machine learning tutorial. We start with the tutorial and then we move on to three long paper presentations, file injection attacks, a break, and then advanced persistent threats paper, and on which Anoop is a co-author, and the FishGAN paper, and then we have a short paper on cyber adversarial intrusion as a user study, I believe. And the next slide, please. So looking ahead, so you went too far, yeah. Looking ahead, we are planning for IWSPA 2021, and it will be again together with ACM CODASPY 2021, and it's being planned for the Baltimore, Washington, D.C. area in March 2021. And the dates, I believe, are March 22 to 24. And IWSPA's co-chairs, I'm pleased to tell you that we have Chilukuri Mohan and Andrew Sung have accepted to be the co-chairs for IWSPA 2021. And I have asked them to give you a short presentation at the end of the afternoon session today. They have joined us, both of them. So welcome, everybody. And the submission deadline is likely to be in early December 2020. And with that, Avisha, next slide, please. I'm going to end my presentation. Thank you all. Let's move to the keynote now. So it's a great pleasure for me to introduce Anoop Singhal, who is a senior computer scientist and also program manager at NIST, and he has been there for quite some time. He also had worked at AT&T Bell Labs before NIST, and I believe George Mason University. So he has had quite a number of interesting positions and roles, and I'm sure he's familiar to many of you because he has co-authored a book also on attack graphs and security risk analysis. He is a senior member of IEEE, and he has also been an adjunct faculty at George Mason, where he teaches lots of graduate courses and so on. So Anoop, we can start. It's a real pleasure to have you, and thank you very much for accepting our invitation to be the keynote speaker today.
Okay, thank you, Rakesh. Thank you, everybody, for attending this workshop. Can you people hear me okay?
Yes, I can hear you.
Okay, good. Okay. All right. So, yeah, welcome to the workshop. And again, it's a privilege for me to give this talk on security metrics and risk analysis for enterprise systems. Just as a short note, basically, I'm currently located in New Jersey, and we had a big storm yesterday. So as a result, we lost power yesterday around 11 a.m. or so, and we still don't have power. So today in the morning, I was scrambling a little bit how to arrange for this talk. Luckily, I found another place where I have internet and access and power and Wi-Fi, but I haven't been able to share. So just bear with my looks today, and then hopefully this will go well, okay? All right, so I have planned a presentation of about 30 minutes, and then if there are any questions, we can always get them later. Or if you have anything really important, you can always stop me and I can answer those, right? Okay, so as Rakesh mentioned, basically I am with the Computer Security Division at NIST, and we've been working on this topic for about last 10 years. So here's the outline for my talk. Can you people see the slides okay?
Yeah, they look fine.
Okay. So I will briefly mention some challenges for cybersecurity risk analysis. Then I'll talk briefly about security metrics and how attack graphs can be used to measure security. And then we've been working on this for the last 10 years. So we have several papers, and we kind of summarize this and put it into a book on network security metrics that was published by Springer Verlag about 2 years ago. So if you're interested in more details and learning more about our work, you're welcome to look at this book. And now we've been working briefly on this. We just started working on this advanced persistent threats. And so I thought maybe I will introduce this topic, briefly in this keynote. We have a paper in this workshop, and one of our students, Tim Tan, will be presenting that in more detail. But I'll just introduce this, what are the problems, and then briefly, give some kind of a, we have developed a framework for detecting these APTs. So I'll mention about that and then give my conclusions. Okay. All right. So what is the main problem in enterprise security management? Basically, the main problem is that the systems are getting large and they are quite complex. A lot of software and vendors and all those compose a typical complex system. And unfortunately, the software running on these systems have vulnerabilities that are constantly discovered. Right, so the vulnerabilities are basically either mistakes by programming, by programmers, or inadvertently something else happened. So as a result, security management is a challenging task. And even a small distributed system can have numerous attack paths. Basically, there are several ways by which an attacker can come into your system, exploit these vulnerabilities, and then reach their target. Okay, so that is one of the main challenge, and the security management part of a complex system, whether it's a financial management or any other complex system, it's more of an art and it's not a science, in the sense that with experience people know, okay, that these are important vulnerabilities, this is what I should patch first and so on. And the system administrators basically they operate by instinct and learned experience. So there is no objective way to measure for an enterprise system. So it's not like measuring length or measuring volume and things like that. So there is no typical quantitative numbers to say, okay, given this enterprise, given these components and how they're interconnected, what kind of security risk is there currently? And what can I do to mitigate this risk? So for example, if I change this network configuration, or if I patch this vulnerability, will my system be less secure, or will it be more secure? Right? So basically, it's more of intuition rather than really using some kind of a model to measure security and then to reason about it. Okay. And we all are very concerned about security, and the thing is that we want to improve it. It's like improving your health, but unfortunately, as you cannot improve if you cannot measure. So there has to be some objective way to measure security and then use that to be able to improve on the system security. Yeah. Okay. Some simple questions that you would like an answer, for example, is how secure is the database in a given network configuration? So if you have a database server that contains some PII information or some other confidential information, and given it's inside some system with some interconnectivity from outside, can we answer the question how secure it is? It's not like security is never like 100% or 0%, right? So how secure is it in this given network configuration? That's a difficult question. Is it 90%, is it 70%, and so on? And then if I change something in my configuration, if I disconnect some devices or I add some more components, how does this new configuration, how much security does my new configuration provide, right? So those are some difficult questions that need to be answered. And then the other question is that the CIO or the CEO, they don't have infinite amount of money to invest for security, right? So the question is, how can I plan on security investments for a certain amount of security. So for example, you know, I have a certain fixed amount of budget, and I'm okay to have, you know, 90% of the cases covered. I mean, even if 10% are not covered, it's fine. So how can I plan on these investments so that it provides me a certain amount of security, right? So in order to answer these questions, basically, there's a need of a system security modeling and analysis tool. So we need to have a tool which can, given a system with a set of vulnerabilities and the interconnectivity and other things and the threats, how can we use this tool to kind of model the system? And just like doing performance modeling, so how can we do security modeling, you know, to be able to reason about security for a given system with vulnerabilities? So that's the main motivation for our work, and that's the reason why we've been pursuing this work for the last 10 years, and we are still continuing to make more progress in this area. Okay, so as I mentioned before, I start on my formal, you know, whatever slides and presentation that I have, I wanted to give you a small short overview of our book. So this is a book on network security metrics that came out recently. And these are the four chapters in this book, just as a high level description. And you're welcome, it's Springer Verlag. You can Google it and take a look at the summary. And if interested, you can, take from the library and things like that. So here are the main chapters. The main chapters are like security risk analysis. That's the first chapter on which my talk is based on. Then we also have some other chapters on like zero-day kind of vulnerabilities. So the current talk is more on existing vulnerabilities. So that we know these vulnerabilities, but as you know, there are a lot of undiscovered vulnerabilities. So how do we reason with those zero-day vulnerabilities? And the second chapter is on this concept of K0-day safety, which is basically how do we make our system resilient against unknown attacks? And the third chapter is on metrics for attack graph analytics. And then finally, the fourth chapter is on how do we detect zero-day attack paths. So there are the zero-day attack paths are basically composed of exploiting vulnerabilities which are not discovered. So how can we detect those? What kind of methodology we can follow to detect those? So that's the general overview of this book. Okay, all right. So that was general introduction. Now I will talk briefly about what is an attack graph and how we can use attack graph as a model to be able to measure security and to be able to improve security and so on. Okay. So an attack graph is basically very simple. It's a model for how an attacker can combine vulnerabilities to stage an attack. You know, for example, a data breach. They want to get into your database system and steal some information. So it's a model of to show how these vulnerabilities can be combined as stepping stones to reach a server and then to be able to, you know, get access to some confidential data. And it also shows the dependencies among vulnerabilities. So basically, the vulnerabilities, what the attacker does is that after exploiting one vulnerability, there are some post conditions like privilege escalation. And then he uses that post condition as a precondition for exploiting some other vulnerabilities. So it's like a chain, and the attack graph basically models this kind of a chain of how these vulnerabilities can be exploited. So I'll show you a very small example to illustrate the concept of attack graph. And then we will talk about a real network and how we can model that using attack graphs. Okay. So in this small example, basically let's assume that there are only two machines in this network. So there is a file server machine running secure shell server as well as FTP server. And there is a second machine which is running the database server. You can also have FTP files in this machine. And they are interconnected by a router, then there's an external firewall, and then attacker is basically trying to come in from the outside to reach the database server and get access to your get access to your information. So in this small network, there are several paths that the attacker can take to reach to your database server. And we are assuming that there are some vulnerabilities. So the vulnerabilities are that the secure shell server has a buffer overflow vulnerability, and the database server has another vulnerability, which is a local buffer overflow. So buffer overflows are typical vulnerabilities whereby the user can exploit those and become a user on that machine. So one path a user can take is from machine 0 to 1, he or she can exploit this vulnerability and become a user on machine 1. Then from machine 1, he can do an FTP of .r hosts from 1 to 2. And then he can RSS from machine 1 to 2. So he can now become a user on machine 2. And then from 2, he can now do a local buffer overflow exploit and become a user on machine 2. So that's one path that the attacker can take. The other way the attacker can reach machine 2 is that he can just do an FTP of .r hosts from 1 to 0, then do an RSH to reach 1, and then from 1, he can do again the same thing, FTP .r hosts and reach machine 2, and then after reaching machine 2, then he can do a buffer overflow on machine 2, and become a user on machine 2. Now, so that's the second path. The third path he can do is that he doesn't have to go to machine 1 at all. So he can, from machine 0, he can go to 2 directly by FTPing the .r host file, reach machine 2, and then after reaching machine 2, then he can just do a local buffer overflow on machine 2 and become a user on machine 2, right? So basically, even if the small network can have these three different paths for the user to reach machine 2 and get access to the data in the database server. So now, given these three paths, the attack path basically models the different ways in which the attack graph models the different ways in which the attacker can come into the system. So there's one path is this one, from 0 to 1, 1 to 2, and so on. The other path is this one. So it's like a tree. And then these are shared, these nodes are shared, the two paths. And then the third path is from 0 to 2, and then reaching the machine 2 directly and exploiting this part, right? So the target is here, and that's where the attacker wants to reach from the machine 0. Okay. So that's what the basic model of the attack graph is. And now the question is, how can we use this attack graph to measure security, right? So evidently, more paths there are, the more easy it is to exploit, and the less secure the system is, right? But currently, we don't have any measure from this about how much security the system has. So therefore, we need some weights on these nodes. And given these weights in these nodes, then we can measure the overall security of the system. So to do that, what we do is that we use something called vulnerability scoring system. So as you know, all vulnerabilities are not equal, you know? Because some vulnerabilities are easier to exploit as compared to other ones. So therefore, the scoring system basically gives some kind of a score between 0 to 10 to say how difficult it is to exploit the vulnerability. So this CVSS model was also developed at NIST. I'm sure some of you have looked at this document. And it's a way to give a scoring to the system. And it's kind of complex, but I'll just give you a high-level summary for the scoring system, and then show you how the scoring system can be used to basically, you know, reason about security metrics. So the CVSS has basically three components, or three groups. There's a base component, there's a temporal component, and there's an environmental component. So I have described that briefly in this slide, and we are not going to go into a lot of details on this, but the thing that's most important in this is the base metric group. Okay, the base metric group basically has different components. So these different components contribute to the score for this vulnerability. Okay? So there's access vector, which is saying that how can I reach this vulnerability? Okay, is it, I have to be locally on this machine, or do I have to be remote? I can be adjacent, or can I be remote anywhere? So that's one component. And access complexity is the access easy to get to, and then authentication, do I need authentication to be able to exploit this, or is it without any authentication? And then the other parts are, what kind of impact does this vulnerability have? Is it like partial, is it total, impact, and so on? So there are three parts to this impact: confidentiality, or integrity, or availability. Yeah? Any of these three components of security can be impacted. Yeah? So that's the base metric group, and currently we are only using the base metric group. So we are not going to discuss the details about temporal and the environment part as far as the scoring system is concerned. Okay, so let's take a small example to illustrate how this works. So I've taken a CVE example from the past, and this is basically a vulnerability found in the Apache web server. And it's basically like a memory corruption vulnerability, and it causes an availability impact. So it causes the web server to go down, and the different components, as I said, the access vector for this is that you can be anywhere in the network. So the score for this is 1.0, and then the access complexity is low because it doesn't need too much skill to access this. So the score is 0.71. There's no authentication. The score is 0.704. And then availability is complete. So basically, it can bring the web server down if you exploit this vulnerability. So as a result, the score for this component is 0.66. So given these base scores, now we have some equations which will convert this into using these components, how to compose the complete score for this vulnerability. So the base score for this comes to 7.8. So on a scale of 1 to 10, this vulnerability has a score of 7.8. So the higher the score is, basically the more easy it is to exploit this vulnerability. So now what we can do is that we can use this score as some kind of probability to exploit this vulnerability. So let's go back to our example and then see how these scores can be used to reason about the security of the system. Okay. So in this case, we are saying that we annotate this graph with the probabilities for exploiting these vulnerabilities. And as you know, FTP is pretty simple to do. So we have given it a high score of 0.8. And then secure shell server needs, the buffer overflow needs more skills, so therefore it has given a score of 0.1. Of course, so this is just an example here, but in real case, the scores will come out of CVSS. Right? CVSS will tell us, for real vulnerabilities, it will tell us the actual scores. So given this attack graph, now we've annotated it with some scores from CVSS, which gives the some kind of weights or some kind of probabilities for the exploitation of these vulnerabilities. Okay. So now the thing is, given this graph now, how can we do a composition of these probabilities to get the overall metrics of the system? Okay. So as you see that this graph is basically AND OR graph. So what we can say is that when one exploit follows another exploit, when it's an AND, it means to reach here, we need to exploit both of them. So therefore, it's an ANDing of these two probabilities, and therefore we multiply them. And that's the probability of reaching here. And whereas for this node, either you can come from this side or you can come from this side. And therefore, we can do an OR of these two vulnerabilities and then AND it with this one. And that becomes a probability to reach this node, to exploit this vulnerability, right? So you can do an AND OR of these probabilities, and that's how you will get the probability of actually reaching this particular, the end node, where the real database server and you can access the data. So for this example, if you do these computations, then the probability comes to 0.087. So basically, this in some way is a measure of the security of your system. that this gives the overall probability or some kind of a metric of how secure the system is. So that's the main idea of how we can use attack graphs to be able to measure system security. So now, as you know, that some of our small system, it's easy to do it by hand. So one can basically, take this small example, put the CVSS scores on that, and then be able to compute the overall probability. But for a complex system which has several software components running and several vulnerabilities, it's not like you can do by hand. So therefore, we have built an automated system. I collaborated with Professor Zhao at Kansas State. Now he's at Florida in Tampa. And we developed a tool called Mulval, which is basically like a data log-based multiple vulnerability analysis tool. And what that does is that given these systems in the network, for example, and given that we have these OVAL descriptions, open vulnerability analysis language, description for these systems, which have a list of all the vulnerabilities. So we can access all those vulnerabilities. So one input is the vulnerabilities in the system. The second input is NVD, which is the National Vulnerability Database, that was also developed at NIST. And it has a list, it has a description of each vulnerability, how it can be exploited, what are the preconditions and postconditions. So that's the second input. And then the other inputs are, for example, network reachability, threat model of the system, and some user information in terms of what browsers they are running and how competent your browsers are, things like that. So that's the third component. And using these inputs, what Mulval does is that it takes all these inputs and then it will generate to you the complete graph of this system automatically. And then along with that, it can generate the metrics of what is the current security posture, security probability for the system. So that's what the purpose of this system is. So this is open software. If you are interested, you can download it. And then you can play with it and see how it works. Okay. So now let me give you given all this and given that I have about 5-6 minutes more, now what I'll do is I'll take a small realistic example, a realistic network, and see how Mulval tool was used to evaluate the security of the system and then come up with a way to reduce the risk, or to mitigate risk for the system. Okay, so let's take this example. So here basically what we have is we have a typical system which basically has, we have an external firewall which is connected to the outside internet and an internal firewall. And the web server is sitting in the DMZ area. And then we have user workstations and then the internal database server. So the internet is allowed to access the web server. You can reach here. And then the web server, you can go to the database server to access the data, MySQL database, and user workstations are allowed to access anything. So your user workstation, so you, typically the user is on a browser, but the browser is accessing the database. Okay. So let's suppose this is a small example of a real network. And for this example, several vulnerabilities were identified. So the web server has some vulnerability, and the database server has another vulnerability, and then the user workstation on the running a browser which has a vulnerability through which they can do some social engineering attack. So given these vulnerabilities, basically there are multiple paths. So the multiple paths are that the attacker can first exploit this vulnerability on the web server and then reach the database server, the attacker can exploit a vulnerability on the browser that the user is running on this workstation, and do a social engineering attack, become a user on this user workstation, and then be able to access the database server, right? Or you can access from the web server, the attacker can then go to the database server, right? So given these this example, there are multiple paths that I'm showing in red dotted lines through which the attacker can ultimately reach the database. Okay, so I mean, I'm not going to go into details, but basically we have a report, a NIST report on this, which I'll point to when I reach the references area. And this shows the resulting attack graph for this, the output attack graph. If you run this tool to get the overall attack graph for the system and the metric and the complete scoring for this security. So this is the end node, and the node target is to reach node one. And as you can see, the numbers after the nodes here give the probability. So the overall probability for reaching this node is 0.47. So that's the result of composition of all these probabilities and reaching the end node. So there are multiple notations here. I'll not go through all that, but the squares basically represent initial configurations, and the ovals represent the exploiting of these vulnerabilities, and then the diamonds indicate the result of the exploitation and reaching that vulnerability. Okay? And the numbers in the nodes give the probability of reaching those. So basically, the probabilities get propagated and eventually reach this one. So now the question is, how can we use this graph to mitigate risk, right? So what we can say is, what if we patch the database server? What if we patch the workstation, right? We patch the workstation, then some part of this graph will go away, right? Some edges will go away. And then we run the tool again, and then it will come up with a new probability. So in this case, what we find is that by patching the vulnerability on the user workstation, you get the maximum improvement in security. So by using this tool, basically, you can do what-if scenarios and then use that to be able to improve security and reasonable security. Okay? So that's the end result of using this tool. Okay. So I think I have a couple more minutes. So I'll just briefly, so as I already mentioned about this main result for running the tool on our system and the output that we can use.
Yeah, you have 3 or 4 minutes.
Yeah, okay. So I mean, I'm not going to talk in a lot of details about this, but this is also part of our security metrics work. And as I said before, our students, will be presenting a full paper in the afternoon. You're welcome to attend that. And the paper is basically, the topic is on advanced persistent threats. As you know, there are a lot of these slow and stealthy attacks which happen with steal, your PII or your information without being detected, and they keep happening. So the question is, what are some of the challenges in detecting these attacks, and how we can use machine learning to be able to detect some of these attacks? Okay. So I mean, just as a short introduction to that paper. Basically, it is, as I said, it consists of multiple steps, and they are stealthy, so it's hard to detect them. And we want to develop a framework that can use, so some of these steps don't have any signatures, so it's not like we know about these vulnerabilities. So how can we use machine learning to detect these steps and then be able to reason about these steps? All right. So, I mean, I won't describe in detail about this one, but that's the basic flowchart for how an APT occurs. You do an initial compromise, and then you keep going from one system to another, and so on. And then eventually you reach your gold mine, from where you want to get your real data and then data exfiltration. So that's the overall flow diagram for an APT. And the details of our system will be described for the afternoon. Okay, so that's about brings me to the end of my talk. And I just want to point to you some important references. Of course, Professor Rakesh has all our slides, and he's welcome to post them. But we have several papers and the important report on security risk analysis came out from NIST. You're welcome to take a look at that. It's online. And then we have some other papers on zero day and also on forensic analysis for these attacks. So all these papers have been published, and you're welcome to take a look and learn more about our work. And if you send me an email, I'll be happy to answer back and reply to you if you have any questions. And then this is the book that came out on network security metrics in 2018, which is also a good source for getting some of this information. Okay. All right, very good. So basically, in conclusion, what I presented is how we can use attack graphs as a model for security risk analysis, and how composing individual scores can be used to measure overall system security. Okay. And the future work is how to apply these techniques for doing mission impact analysis. So the thing is, if you have to couple your system's mission. So your mission may be, for example, flying planes or to fulfill some work order. So how do we couple the mission of the business mission with the vulnerabilities, and then be able to reason about that and how to make a system resilient so that your actual tasks can be still completed in spite of these vulnerabilities. Okay, so that's about it as far as my talk is concerned, and I'll be happy to take any questions.
Thank you very much, Anoop. And we are ready for some questions. That was an excellent introduction to attack graphs and a little bit about the paper that will be in the afternoon session on advanced persistent threats. So very nice. So anybody has a question, please go ahead and unmute yourself and you can ask. We have some time for questions.
I have a question.
Yeah, please go ahead.
So Anoop, I've been following your work like since a few years, because I'm working on a little bit similar area. I've read Bart's review book on attack graphs. One of my questions was related how you identified dependencies between vulnerabilities. So in some of your papers, you've mentioned that you use natural language processing. So how you create those dependencies? Have you used any semantics? Have you used any like reasoning to create those dependencies between attributes? Because if I understand correctly, the attack graph is a directed graph. So it requires some dependencies or relationships between attack nodes. So can you elaborate on that, please? Thank you.
Yeah. Okay, yeah, good. So that's a good question. And basically the dependencies are made using post conditions and preconditions, you know. So the idea is that when you exploit a vulnerability, it results in some post condition. And those post condition could become preconditions for another vulnerability, you know. So for example, after you exploit a certain vulnerability, there may be you may become a super user, or you may become a user on that system, right? So once you become a user on that system, then this could become a precondition for the next vulnerability. And when all the preconditions for certain vulnerability is satisfied, then that vulnerability can be exploited, right? So the link between vulnerabilities is basically made. Each vulnerability is modeled using preconditions and post conditions, and that's how the dependencies are made.
And if you allow me, so those pre and post conditions are identified automatically, or you just hard code them in the system?
Okay, so those are provided in NVD, the National Vulnerability Database, that is developed by NIST, So for each vulnerability, those are identified. You know? Those are already identified, but they are in English language. So those have to be translated into a programming system. So that's what, when we do the malware modeling, then when you write the malware program, that's when you write those preconditions and postconditions. Yeah. And we are looking into how we can automate that. Right now it's not automated. It's basically the developer of the program has to be able to create that program manually, you know, put those preconditions and postconditions by looking at the NVD and description of each vulnerability. Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions?
Hi, this is Ram Krishnan from UT San Antonio.
Yeah, hi, Ram.
Hi, Anup. Thanks for the nice talk. I have a sort of the scores calculation that you showed in the attack graph is somewhat interesting to me.
Yeah.
It seems like semantics of that score could be different for different attackers. So in other words, if the score is indicative of how easy a particular vulnerability is to be exploited, then it could have one kind of metric versus how serious that vulnerability is, then that score could have a different kind of metric, right? The unit for the score.
Yeah.
So in a sense, the problem seems even more complex because you could have two different attack graphs with two different sets of associated scores.
Right.
Or many different sets of associated scores.
Mm-hmm.
Potentially even combinations of these, right?
Right.
So then when you do the final analysis for the score computation, you may have to combine these multiple graphs to get a better sense. I don't know if that what I'm saying makes sense, but what is a unit for that score, you know?
Yeah, the idea is that, I mean, currently what we are trying to see is more of how easy it is to exploit that vulnerability. Of course, the score can be, you can choose a score depending on what your requirement is, right? That's not something which is implicit inside the system.
Mm.
So the scores is something we are reading from outside, and some of them can come from experience and users as well, right? So for example, if the social engineering attack, then there is no automated way to read that from some manual, right? Or some database description.
Right.
So it's basically how competent your programmers are, how easy it is to kind of exploit them. So therefore, some of them are user-driven as well. So in some sense, the scores is something what we gave is in one example of how we can use the CVSS scoring system, which gives exploitability as a score, and use that to be able to come up with overall risk of your system. But right. You could use some other things to annotate your graph and then use that as well. You know? So we are kind of open to what kind of inputs you might give it. You know?
Right, so when you combine those scores, when you combine those graphs together, it seems like this can actually be even more complex, right?
Yeah, right. So it can have multiple dimensions. And this is an initial way to do it, you know, but depending on your need, you can always customize it to whatever your requirement is, you know. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, we have time for one or two more questions. Okay, if nobody else is asking, then Anup, I will ask one question about the probabilities. How do you estimate these probabilities? And you also had P, A, and B when there is an OR, right? So you had P, A times P, B. So how do you come up with the dependence of these probabilities? Is there some kind of independence assumption when there are parallel paths?
One is how do we come up with the numbers, right?
Right.
The numbers for each vulnerability are generated by some experts, you know. So okay. When a vulnerability is discovered and we characterize that vulnerability at NIST, then we consult with some experts and they give the individual scores for the access vector for the access complexity, exploitability, and so on. Okay. So those come from some experts who give those numbers. And then we have some statistical equations. We try to combine them together to give one composite score. Okay? So that's the first answer to your question. Mm-hmm. And then the issue about composing these, yeah, we are currently assuming that vulnerabilities are independent. So if we exploit, if a attacker is exploiting vulnerability one, followed by vulnerability two, then they're independent. So therefore we can use probabilistic. Okay. But again, you can customize this and say that if there is some dependencies, then depending on that, I can do my composition in a better way or something. But this is a one way to do it, and it's something better than nothing. You know?
Yeah.
So the idea is that you have one way to get some number about your system, and then it seems intuitive, and then you can use that to kind of improve and see which vulnerabilities to patch first, so that you can reduce the graph and improve the security of the system.
Yeah, makes sense. Thank you very much, Anu. Great talk. And I think we had some interesting questions as well. So let's thank Anu one more time. You can unmute yourself and clap if you like.
Okay, thank you very much. Yeah, it was enjoyable to give this talk, and hope to see you people real live presentation in some other conference or this conference next year. Okay.
Yeah, so it's very close to where you are next year. Hopefully it will happen, you know, and we'll meet each other over there.
Sounds good.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Thank you.
Bye. So we are going to move on to a paper presentation now. So Avisha will start the recording, and then after the recording ends, we'll give a couple of minutes to the authors to make some remarks, and after that we'll have a short Q&A and then a break. So Avisha, I believe it's on my morning agenda. So can you start the privacy preserving SVM paper recording? It's by Hua Jie Chen, Ali Burak, Unal, Mete Agun, and Nico Pfeiffer. Avisha, are you muted or something?
No, Dr. Verma. I think it's...
Because I can't hear any sound from the video. So maybe you want to turn on...
I'm not muted.
I can hear you now. Yeah.
Can I... you can hear me, right?
Right.
Can you hear the...
I think the video is paused now.
Yeah, but can you hear the video audio? If I play,
I can't hear it, but maybe my hearing is very poor. So somebody else can hear it. Can you play it again?
I'm playing it now. It's.
I can't hear it either.
So. Okay.
I can.
Did you enable system audio when you share your screen?
Yeah, maybe just share it one more time. Just stop sharing and try again.
Okay.
Background introduction.
Yeah.
Machine learning methods have...
Just go back to
Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Hua Jiechen. Welcome to my presentation of our work, namely privacy-preserving SVM on outsourced genomic data via secure multi-party computation, which was finished by Hua Jiechen, Ali Burak Yuno, Mete Akgun, and Nicole Pfeiffer.
Let's begin with the first section, namely background introduction. Machine learning methods have been widely employed in many scientific research areas recently, solving problems by discovering hidden patterns in data. Applying machine learning methods, e.g. support vector machines, or medical data enables detection of patterns which were previously unknown or too hard for a human entity to recognize. Hence, it can be a contribution to medical technology development. For instance, novel HIV drug resistance mutations have been characterized by using clustering, multidimensional scaling, and an SVM, network-based outcome prediction method with the core of sparse group lasso regression, has been programmed to predict the breast.
The loss of control of the data could potentially result in a lot of challenges and problems. In the cloud, which is a shared resource, a lot of other applications are running and the machines are in the control of, let's say, the cloud owners. And therefore, the data can be vulnerable, especially when you're outsourcing sensitive data. Shan, the next slide. So the question, how do you handle outsourcing? The most common way in which we basically address this issue is by encrypting the data prior to basically uploading it onto the cloud. So encryption is part of the solution of how do you basically make sure that the data is not vulnerable to essentially attacks on the cloud side. Now, there are two distinct models one can sort of use when dealing with the cloud. The first is a straightforward mechanism to basically ensure that your data remains safe is to actually encrypt the data on the cloud. And whenever you need to use it, you just bring it back, decrypt it in your local host, and then process your applications and then basically re-encrypt the data and send it back. Now, if you do something like this, that is sort of not, Chandu, if you can click through. So that solution is not a viable solution because the whole purpose of outsourcing to a large degree is to exploit the resources on the cloud side, whether it be computational resources or storage resources or anything else. And therefore that model sort of doesn't work out. In the last, let's say, 20 years, what we have experienced is a variety of solutions where we are able to process computation and queries on the encrypted domain itself. The idea is that the encryption mechanism is such that it has homomorphic properties so that you can sort of execute your most of the query that you want to execute or most of the computation you want to do onto the cloud side in the encrypted domain, bring the data back after, bring the answer back essentially when the computation is over and decrypt it then on the local side. Okay, all right, next slide. So if we think of, let's say, data being stored even though in the encrypted domain on the cloud side, there are a variety of challenges that that arise and a variety of attacks that can possibly launch on the data. So for instance, depending on the way the data is encrypted and stored, there could be ciphertext attack. So for instance, if you use something like a deterministic encryption mechanism where, let's say, two objects have the which have the same value, they're encrypted exactly the same way, this would reveal some information about the object, the fact that these two records basically have the same value because the ciphertext representation is identical to the in both cases, in case the object object is the same object or the same value. And that will lead to attacks, potentially. The attack can further happen based also on the prior knowledge of the adversary about the data's distribution or any such thing. So there are several types of attacks that are possible, including access pattern attacks and the attack from the output size. This is one of the most harder ones to deal with because in a domain where you're sort of dealing with, let's say, processing on the encrypted data, and finally what the adversary the cloud returns to you is basically the final answer, the size of the answer could itself reveal some information. And to a degree, this is very difficult to deal with because the whole purpose of outsourcing the data and processing on the cloud side was to essentially implement the entire query on the cloud. And this could lead to basically a problem because the size of the output itself reveals information about the data. So essentially, there are several types of attacks that are possible. This mixed with the adversarial knowledge that adversary may have or background could reveal significant information about the sensitive data itself. Next slide. Chandu? Okay, so there, in the past, let's say, 2 decades, a very large amount of work has been done in the context of trying to develop encryption mechanisms which have, as I said, homomorphic properties so that one can execute queries on the cloud side. These relatively recently, in the last, let's say, a decade or so, around a decade or so, there has been significant progress also on information theoretic sort of approaches, including multi-party computation and secret sharing. The idea in terms of using them to do query processing and computation on the cloud side. The idea of secret sharing working in this context is that the assumption we make is that there are several clouds which are available to us, which are non-colluding. So if we have non-colluding several clouds, we will outsource data by creating shares on the secret shares of them to those clouds, such that the data is individually stored in the individual cloud. The cloud cannot tell what the data is, and this at all. This is completely secure from an information theoretic perspective, and I think Shantanu will explain this in a couple of minutes as to how this is done using secret sharing. But the idea is that this approach ensures that the data stored on each cloud is completely safe from any kind of attack that the adversary may be able to launch. The only way in which you can sort of lose this is if the clouds start colluding. So in general, there are assumptions that you'll make in this approach that there are K clouds, the maximum number of clouds that can collude with each other are, let's say, K. And so you want to be safe on top of, let's say, maximum number of collisions that can happen, which may be K. And when the computation has to happen on, let's say, secret shared data, each cloud can individually compute on their shares independently. And finally, the results are sort of combined to give you the answer back. This combination is done on a trusted platform. It will be done in this case by the basically the data owner or the querier, who will then combine the results to sort of get the actual answers. So I think the technique of this, how this works, is what the focus of today's tutorial is. And what Shantanu will do is start from a simple model of how secret sharing works, or assuming secret sharing works, and then should build from there onwards, show how computation can be done, how simple operations like aggregations can be done on top of secret shared data, and then followed by how searches can be done, and then how we are able to do on top of this more or less a very large amount of SQL processing. So I think with that, let me hand it over to Shantanu to explain the secret sharing and how computation is done using secret sharing in a cloud setting.
Hi, so I will explain first what is secret sharing. So secret sharing techniques are much secure as compared to encryption-based techniques. So encryption-based techniques are computationally secure, means if the adversary has enough computation power, then they can break it. So for example, a couple of years ago, Google showed that they can break SHA-1 in only less than 1 hour. Because they have so much computational power to break this technique. However, on the other hand, information theoretically secure techniques, they are computationally secure. Even if the adversary has any amount of power, they cannot break it. So, and they are also the quantum secure. So first, what is the secret sharing? So the idea of secret sharing comes from a simple how we can draw a line on a graph paper. So suppose if we are giving a single point on the graph paper, then how many lines we can draw from this point? So the answer is infinite lines. But what about if we are giving 2 points on the same line, on the same graph paper, then we can draw only a single line from these 2 points. And whenever this line crosses the y-axis, this is my secret. So if I want to, so the idea is this, if I want to create a shares of my secret, I put this value on the y-axis and draw any random line. And whatever random line I can draw, I can select multiple points on the line and give each of them to different cloud, and they will become the share. And the cloud can never know the values of the actual secret value. So for example, if Alice wants to share her secret value 5 to Bob and Carl, and Bob and Carl are not communicating with each other, so her secret is 5. She will put secret value 5 on y-axis and draw a random line. And whatever value she can select, for example, in here in this figure, she is selecting 9 and 7. She can give one value to either Bob and Carl. And these guys, Bob and Carl, can never know the secret value 5 because they cannot draw the actual line that will cross the y-axis at position 5. So by this way, these techniques are completely secure. But once they will come collude, Bob and Carl, they will know the actual secret value. So here we select some polynomials, and the degree of polynomials matters as the case of the colluding servers. So if F server will collude, then we need to definitely select F plus 1 degree so that the technique will be completely secure. But if none of the servers are colluding, then there is no need to select a polynomial of degree more than 1. So in this case, if servers are not colluding, polynomial of degree 1 is completely okay. And this technique is also fault tolerant because we can create multiple shares of the same value. So even if I will create 4 or 5 shares, if some of the servers will die, I can still get my data. So suppose here, I have a secret database owner has a secret value S, and they want to create secret shares of this value S to multiple servers. So here are the 4 servers. And suppose the servers are not colluding with each other, so none of the server can know the actual secret value S. Since we use the polynomial of degree 1, we can select the secret from shares from any 2 servers to construct the secret back using Lagrange interpolation. So here he can select shares from either S1 or from S1 or S2 or any 2 other servers. So for example, he can also select from S2 and S4. And after putting this value that he is getting from the servers, he will get the actual secret value using Lagrange interpolation. So this was the basic of the secret sharing technique. And there is another type of secret sharing that is called order preserving secret sharing. So this is similar to order preserving encryption. So what happens in order preserving secret sharing, that if I give you 2 values in clear text where A is less than B, so the secret share of these values will be less, follow the same order. So if the secret share of A is denoted by SA, then it will be less than secret share of B. This technique is efficient for finding maximum, minimum, and the range queries. So now I will show you that how we can use secret sharing techniques and order preserving techniques in outsourcing of database. So first, there are 2 types of secret sharing techniques have been developed. One is in which server communicates with each other during the computation. So the assumption is here is this, the server do not communicate before the computation or after the computation, but during the computation they will communicate, and only some secret value they will communicate that they are computing during the computation. Except this, they don't communicate with each other. The another category is non-communicating servers, where servers do not communicate during the entire computation. They even don't communicate before the computation or after and during the computation. Since in the first category, servers communicate with each other, there is significant communication overhead as compared to the second technique. So we will study 2 techniques of both categories. In the first category, we will study conclave, and in the second category, we will see obscure. So first see the basic example of secret sharing, that what we can do with secret sharing. So suppose we are giving this employee relation and I want to outsource this data using some secret sharing. So I can create shares of all the values very easily. And Summit secret sharing follows additive homomorphic property. So if I want to perform sum of the salary of all the employees from E101 to E103, I can just add the share value at the cloud side. And after adding the share value at the cloud side, whenever I will interpolate at the database owner side, the database owner will get the actual value. So here we the operation is very easy, it's the sum operation, but sum is not only the operation that a database owner wants to perform on the database. There are several other operations that we want to do. So first one, common operation on databases are aggregation with complex selection queries. So for example, I want to perform some operation based on department or based on the location. So how we can do this type of operation? The second one is I want to fetch different rows based on some criteria, selection queries. So how we can do these things? And then finally, how we can join multiple tables on secret shared data. So I will cover only first part here, aggregation with complex selection. So before going to aggregation queries, first we need to know this thing that how we can search over the share and without remembering any polynomials. So if database owner will remember polynomial for every secret, so suppose John is one secret and Adam is one secret and he is using two different polynomials. So if he will remember that for John I used polynomial 1 and for Adam I used polynomial 2, then this, of course, it will solve the purpose of searching, but it will create huge overhead at the database owner side, because if the database contains 1 million values, then he needs to store 1 million secrets polynomials. So we need to see first a searching technique in which database owner doesn't need to store any polynomial. So the solution is string matching operation over the secret sharing. So this is the paper appeared last year in TCS. So what happens here, this approach follows three steps. So suppose my database contains only three words, A, B, and C. So first thing, the database owner needs to represent them as a simple unary vector. After representing them as unary vector, so for the A, I fix this thing. Whenever I see A, the first position will be 1 and all the remaining position will be 0. Since the dictionary contains only three words, so remaining two position will be 0. If I see B, then second position will be 1 and the remaining two position will be 0. And same thing for C. I cannot outsource these vectors directly to cloud, because based on this information, he will know how many what are the values in the database. So I use different polynomials on these vectors. After applying polynomials, I will create different secret shares and send to cloud. But here is the thing that I need to use the same, the degree of the polynomial should be same in all the different polynomial, whatever I am selecting. If I will change the degree, then searching technique will not work. So for example, the database owner wants to outsource a value B. So first he will represent as unary vector. And for each value, he can select different polynomials. So here he is selecting three different polynomials, but the degree of the polynomial is identical. And now he can place the value of x as 1, 2, 3, and he will get different share that he outsourced to different servers. So on the right-hand side, you will see different share at the three different servers. So now you see here, for example, if I consider the third server is storing value 15, 28, and 6. Based on this value, he can never know the actual value that he is storing is 0, 1, 0. So he can never know that I am storing the value of B. So now if the user wants to search, or the database owner wants to search, okay, B is there or not, or any other word is there. So he needs to follow the same step. He will first represent as unary vector and select any polynomial, but the degree of the polynomial should be same. So here the user or the database owner, they are storing the same degree, only one, some bytes they are storing to store the degree of the polynomial. And after that, they will create different shares. So you can see here, the share that cloud is having from the getting from the database owner as well as from the user, they are different. For example, 5, 10, 2 in the at the first server and 1, 3, 4, they are different, but they are representing the same value in secret share form. So the cloud can never know, okay, I am storing the same world that you are looking for, I am storing the any different world. And in this case, there is no need to share the polynomial between the database owner and the user. So now how we can search this thing? So if you see that server is storing two vectors, V1 and V2. And now if I see the clear text value of these two servers, this is 010, but they are in secret share form. So if I perform the multiplication of these vectors by position, so I will get the some value that is 5, 30 and 8, that will represent 010, and finally I will add it. So final addition will represent the value 1. So based on this identical operation on all the vectors and all the servers that will do, they can never know, okay, what they are doing. But after the computation, they will send the final value 43, 147 and 313 to the user, and user will perform the Lagrange interpolation, as you can see in the polynomial, in the Lagrange interpolation equation below the user. So the final answer is 1. Here the appearance of 1 will show, okay, the value B is appeared at the database owner side, at the server side. So the string matching operation or the search operation is successful. So here every cloud is sending only one value, so there is very significantly less communication, only some bytes each cloud is sending. But now based on this string matching technique, we need to solve the complex operation, that selection and aggregation. So there is a paper system that Obscure that use this string matching techniques, and based on this they execute complex conjunctive queries and disjunctive queries, and they don't require any communication between the servers. In addition, they also provide the result verification method. So for example, this, let's see how they can execute a simple operation. So suppose this is the relation. First, we will create two relations, E1 and E2. On E1 and E2 part is only for the maximum and minimum of the value. So if I want to find the maximum minimum of the salary, I will separate out the that column from the original table and put in the E2 table. To link the exact row, I add two columns in the both table, that is tuple ID. So I add tuple ID in both columns. So one is TID and SSTID, and I also write the same number, tuple index S index column. And here I write in clear text TID. So I add two additional columns. For verification purpose, we also add some other values, but I am not showing right now. So for the first relation, I use Shamir secret sharing with this unary representation. And on the right hand side, I use the order preserving secret sharing, as I told you that I need to preserve the order on this column to execute maximum minimum values. And finally, the database owner will outsource these secret share relation to the cloud. So now see how we can execute count query on this part. So suppose the count query is, I want to find the number of rows that have John, first name as John and salary is 1000. So here, this is, I am showing entire operation in the clear text for the simplicity. So suppose for blue part is showing the column value and the green part is showing the query predicate. So first I perform the string matching operation and it will result in either 1 and 0, as we saw in the previous slide. The same thing we do on the salary part. Finally, we get two vectors, V1 and V2, and we multiply these vectors. And the finally we add the values, and final answer 1 will give the answer to the count query. So now you see here, first I perform multiplication on the name and salary side, and then we multiply the vector. So it, now we are increasing the degree of polynomial by multiplication. But can, what will happen if we have less number of servers, how we can solve the problem? The answer is we can solve the problem, but it will increase the communication round and the computation time. So first, before going to the number of servers, let's see, is it oblivious or not? So on each value of the database, I perform the same operation. For name, I search John against all the values. So I perform the identical operation, multiplication, addition. That's why this is completely oblivious. And adversary cannot learn anything based on the representation of the data or the query predicate. And there is no output size attack because they are sending only some bits for after addition over the entire data set. So now see here that what is the impact of the number of shares. So suppose I add one more predicate in the same query that I show you in the last slide. So now I want to count number of rows that have name John and salary equal to 1000 and age equal to 40. So here is the answer that I will get three vectors, V1, V2, and V3. I multiply them and finally add the value. So I will get the final answer 3. So here you can see that, for example, the polynomial degree after 3 multiplication will be 3. So I need at least 4 clouds. So suppose now I have only 3 clouds. How we can solve this thing? So in this scenario, I will multiply any two vectors. So suppose I multiply V2 and V3 and I get another vector V prime. So in this case, I need to send this entire vector V prime to the user and V1 also to the user. So user will interpolate these two vectors first, and then he will multiply and add the values to get the final count of the this query. So this way we are increasing the communication cost as well as the computation cost at the user side when we have less number of shares. So these are the sum numbers. So suppose if we do this thing using non-communicating servers, so if 1 million rows are given of TPCH line item table, so it takes at most 13 seconds. And in case of 6 million row, it takes 50 seconds. And if we follow the simply downloading scheme that Sarah told you at the beginning, that if I download and decrypt the data and perform the operation, then it is significantly slower as compared to performing operation at the cloud side and getting only the data. So these are the result verification approach result. I am not going to here. So now see the multiple cloud thing and conclave. So as I told you that we need to support multiple clouds, multiple database on a data outsourcing to the same database, same servers. So how we can do this thing? Obscure can do it, but it needs to check the all the rows. So how we can reduce the number of operation on the entire data? So Conclave is the solution. So for example, here, if I have three database owners, UCI, UCLA, and UC San Diego, and they want to find the number of employees based on each department, So in a trivial way, they can use any MPC system. They will outsource the data to MPC system and MPC system will give the answer for this query. So now here, this is the operation that MPC will do. In MPC, MPC perform first selection criteria, perform the scan for the tuples that have the qualifying selection predicate, then perform the union all, sort based on the department name, group by, and finally produce the answer. So entire operation is going on the MPC side. So we need to reduce this operation because MPC is very complex thing, because in that case, servers are also communicating. So what Conclave is suggesting that you can push multiple operation to the clear text processing. So first, each database owner perform the most of the part that they can do. They do in the clear text. And finally, they outsource the data of the result of the query that they have executed to the MPC domain. So here, they executed a scan and these queries in the MPC in their scan sort group by operation on the clear text and send the final answer to the MPC server. So in this case, MPC executed significantly less operation, since first of all, they get less number of rows and perform only group by operation after union all. So the computation time is reduced significantly. They can do some other operation also, but there is a problem that they use trusted party to perform operations such as join and aggregation. Since they use trusted party that can perform some part of the operation for join and aggregation, so the computation time is also reduced. So see the orange line. For 1 million values, they take approximately 50 seconds. While ShareMind, a very famous MPC system, it takes more than 1,000 seconds for 1 million rows. So this was the conclusion part, and that secret sharing techniques are good and they are information theoretically secure. And there is some communication overhead because we are outsourcing to multiple database owner and dealing join and other nested query. This is not very easy task in secret sharing, and we need more than one colluding servers. So just I am not going in details of other things here. So there are some industrial systems are also available that several people are looking for secret sharing based techniques. So Cybernetica, Galois, and Secret Double Octopus, these are the companies that are developing secret share database systems. So these are some details of these systems. And that's it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Shantanu and Sharad, for a great tutorial on you know, how can you outsource your data and still keep it secret and secure. So, you know, now we have time for questions. Please go ahead and unmute yourself if you have any questions. So I will start. So I see that there are quite a few companies getting into this space. So, you know, what kind of, how are they positioning themselves? What kind of value add that they are offering? Can you comment on that a little bit?
Sure. Go ahead, Shantanu.
Yeah. You go.
No, go ahead.
No, I am asking the same thing. You answered this question.
Okay. So I think the in terms of encrypted search, for example, so if you look at things like Microsoft, there's a system called Microsoft Always Encrypt as well. There's Amazon sort of service, which is also offering the encrypted representation, storage, and retrieval. So there are two things that they are trying to do, these companies at least. And then I'll address the secret sharing, the MPC companies separately. So what they are trying to push for is empowering the users, the ability to encrypt this data on their own, and therefore maintain the confidentiality of their own data, instead of sort of trusting entirely on the cloud side. So it's, I think, to a large degree, it is their way of basically pushing back the responsibility of ensuring your own data with the safety and integrity and all that stuff, the data to yourself. And that's one of the things that they are sort of the in the larger context, that's what's happening. And the customers are demanding it because we are dealing increasingly with sensitive data being stored. MPC companies, the companies that are sort of dealing with the Cybernetica, Galois, and so on, their game plan is not that entirely clear because these technologies are very slow. Comparatively speaking, there are good point solutions. I'll give you an example. Like there is stealth technology that we have worked with, and we also worked with Galois and with Cybernetica. So stealth, for example, is offering point solutions. So they'll do certain queries, certain aggregation queries extremely well compared to, let's say, being general purpose sort of softwares. And most of the target of this are these people, these companies, are towards DoD applications. That's sort of because you have the need to, the DoD, as you know, is sort of pushing towards a cloud model, or open cloud model as well, where you need extreme security if you're sort of dealing with DoD data. So most of the applications in that context are in that market space.
I see. And I have a couple of questions on the foundational aspect. So you mentioned that it is quantum secure, right? So are there proofs of quantum security? And also, I would like to know more about the complexity analysis. Are there any lower bounds in this area, for example?
So for example, if you are doing computation, so there are two types of approach, as I told you, that one is based on the communication of where systems are servers are communicating, and another where servers are not communicating. Mm-hmm. Both have different bounds for computation type. Okay. So in first, consider that where the servers are communicating. So they prove the bound for communication also, that how many number of rounds they need to communicate and how many bits they need to flow in each round. Mm-hmm. So the most famous system, ShareMind, they need servers communicate with each other at least two times, and they need to send some bits for every row of the data. And the another, if we consider that non-communicating server, so in that case, there is no aspect of communication, but they prove the bound in terms of the how much computation we need to do at the server side. So since they are representing the data as in terms of unary vector, so it depends on the, first of all, the secret that we are storing, what is the length of the secret, and then the how many word a dictionary is containing. For example, if this is only English alphabet, so 26 times the length of the secret, that many computation, and how many words are there. So we need to perform these many multiplication or and addition operations.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I understand you that there are like upper bounds, but are there any lower bounds or any proof of quantum security?
Yeah, there are some lower bounds. So in ShareMind paper, they are proving lower bound that these many communication step we need to do at least. Nice. And there is a review paper by Amos Bimel in 2006. Mm-hmm. So in their paper, they proved they reviewed several things for communication and computation and different models of secret sharing also.
Mm-hmm.
And there is so quantum security, right? So these techniques are information theoretically secure because you're, as I think Shantanu tried to give a good analogy at the context of, let's say, line drawing, right? Mm-hmm. So if I give you a single point in the line, mm-hmm. then there is no way you can actually construct exactly what the line was because you just have a notion of a point, correct? Mm-hmm. So whether you may have as much computational power or not, the information from a Shannon information theory perspective is incomplete, and therefore the secret is sort of preserved completely. It doesn't necessarily mean that the systems are completely secure, mm-hmm. because some of these techniques might be susceptible to, let's say, output size attacks still. Like, it depends on the technique that you have got and exactly what you're answering. So mm-hmm. there could be some other kind of attacks, but from a ciphertext perspective, these ciphertexts cannot be broken. So they are quantum secure in that sense. Mm-hmm.
So ciphertext attacks are out, basically. Okay, thank you. Any other questions from anyone? All right then, in that case, we are going to thank both of you for an excellent presentation, very clear talk. I enjoyed it very much. And Avisha, you can, Shantanu, you can stop sharing. Uh-huh. And then Avisha, you can start the recording for the short paper, I believe. It's called Diverse Datasets and a Customizable Benchmarking Framework for Phishing by Victor Zhang, Eamon Al-Asal, Shariar Baki, myself, Luis Mores, and Avisha Das.
Good morning. As the MC most likely mentioned, I am Victor Zhang, and I will be presenting the short paper Diverse Datasets and a Customizable Benchmarking Framework for Phishing. This work was a collaborative effort with my colleagues Sharia Baki, Eamon El-Asal, Rakesh Verma, Luis, Felipe Teixeira de Morales, and Avisha Das at the University of Houston's REDAS Lab. First, some administrative business, since I am doing a voiceover for this presentation. Here's my mugshot. While there's a lot of work in the phishing domain developing new features and methods, few studies compare the performance of these methods. We believe that this is the result of two factors. First is the lack of a standard benchmarking dataset. The datasets traditionally used in phishing research, such as Nazario and FishTank, only contain malicious samples, meaning that researchers are forced to collect their own legitimate samples
when evaluating their methods. Second is the work required to perform a comparative study, as researchers must write a lot of code to generate comparable results. The rest of this presentation will consist of two parts. First, I highlight several new datasets my group recently introduced and evaluate them for quality. Then, I introduce our benchmarking framework, FishBench, and the recent improvements made to it. For email datasets, we have three datasets which we have already or will be releasing in the future. Our first dataset is the email benchmarking dataset. It is a balanced dataset consisting of 10,500 legitimate emails and 10,500 phishing emails. To ensure diversity, the emails in this dataset were aggregated from a variety of sources. Phishing emails are collected primarily from Nazario, including its 2015 to 2017 releases, and Spam Assassin, while the legitimate emails were sampled from various WikiLeaks releases, Enron, and the Spam Assassin handset. The IWSPA Anti-Phish version 2.0 dataset is the cleaned version of the dataset used in the anti-phishing pilot 2 years ago. It is an imbalanced dataset with a 9-to-1 legit to phish ratio and consists of 4,585 full-header emails and 5,721 no-header emails. Finally, we have the Bluefin dataset, which consists of about 300 new phishing emails that managed to make it through UH's institutional filters into Dr. Verma's inbox. While we did not perform any analysis on this set, it is likely to be more challenging than the other emails in other datasets and will be released along with the others. For URL datasets, we will be presenting one dataset, the URL benchmarking dataset. Like its email brethren, it is a balanced dataset with a roughly equal number of legitimate and phishing URLs. We collected legitimate URLs using a web crawler with the top 40 websites in each Alexa category as a seed. Since all seed URLs are legitimate, we assume that all URLs encountered by the crawler are legitimate. For phishing URLs, we aggregate URLs from three sources, Fishtank, APWG, and OpenFish, and remove the ones which were dead at the time of collection. Now let's move on to the quality checks. Since we intend the benchmarking datasets to become the standard benchmarking datasets of future phishing research, we evaluate their quality in this section. In evaluating the datasets, we consider two dimensions, diversity and difficulty. We choose diversity because the model's performance on a more diverse dataset will be more indicative of its generalization capabilities, and we choose difficulty because a benchmark needs to be able to separate the wheat from the chaff when distinguishing between models. To measure the diversity of the URL benchmarking dataset, we extracted the domains and top-level domains from the URLs and measured how much of the dataset the top-end domains take up. The results for the domain analysis are in the graph on the right. On the x-axis, we have the number of domains, our n, and on the y-axis, we have the cumulative density of the nth domain, or the portion of the dataset taken up by the n most frequent domains. As you can see from the green line, the legitimate subset is very diverse, with the top 50 legitimate domains taking up a negligible amount of the subset. In contrast, we see that the source dataset for the phishing subset are significantly less diverse, with the top 50 fish tank domains taking up roughly 20% of the dataset, and the top 50 APWG and OpenFish domains taking up over 50% of the dataset. As a result, our phishing subset is significantly less diverse than the legitimate subset. However, it is still more diverse than the APWG dataset, which makes up over 2/3 of the URLs in the dataset. Unlike with URLs, there is no direct analog to a domain which we can count to measure the diversity of an email dataset. So instead, we evaluate its diversity by measuring the opposite, similarity. In particular, we take the emails in the dataset, generate TF-IDF vectors of the contents with and without headers, and compute pairwise cosine similarities of all the emails. If the dataset is sufficiently diverse, then most peers should have a very low cosine similarity, and that is exactly what we find. About 85% of the email peers have less than 10% of cosine similarity, and about 99% of peers have less than 30% cosine similarity. To verify the datasets are sufficiently difficult, we perform several small sample experiments. In these experiments, we repeatedly train classifiers on a small sample of data and measure the average performance on a held-out test set. For the URL benchmarking dataset, we used a sample of 50 instances and performed 30 iterations. Due to the imbalanced nature of the IWSPA V2.0 dataset, we used a stratified sample of 50 legitimate and 10 phishing emails and performed 20 iterations. Our results are on the table to the right. We found that the URL benchmarking dataset was the easiest of the bunch with an average F1 score of 88.08%. On the email side, we found that the email benchmarking dataset produced a F1 score of 68.6%, indicating that it is more difficult than the full-header IWSPA V2.0 dataset, but less difficult than the no-header IWSPA datasets. FishBench is our benchmarking framework for phishing detection, which we previously introduced in a January IEEE Access paper. It supports both email and URL datasets, including downloading of websites, and comes with about 200 features, 10 classifiers, and 12 evaluation metrics. On a very high level, FishBench is structured as 5 modules: input, feature extraction, feature processing, classifiers, and evaluation. The input module, reading datasets, and if desired, downloads websites and network information associated with the URLs. The feature extraction module takes in these datasets and extracts features from them. The feature processing module performs post-processing tasks such as feature ranking and scaling. The classifiers model trains classifiers on the training sets, and the evaluation